What was supposed to be a two-part series on the construction of our cherry mirror frame is actually going to be stretched into a third because, as many of you noted, at the end of the second one, we kind of forgot to talk about how we're attaching the mirror itself to the frame. So we're going to do that in today's episode.
Welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop. Today's episode is sponsored in part by Highland Woodworking. Visit their website at highlandwoodworking.com. And also by Lee Valley and Veritas. Visit their website at leevalley.com. And by viewers like you when you make purchases through our various affiliate links at mattsbasementworkshop.com.
Welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop Podcast. As I mentioned, we were going to do just a two-part series on the construction of the cherry mirror frame. But as always, I asked for some comments and some questions about what we ended up doing in the last couple of episodes. And as many of you pointed out, I kind of missed a big step, which was actually installing the mirror itself. How did we go about doing that? And I will admit, that's a huge oversight on my part. So we're going to come back today and talk a little bit about it. Now, what I'm going to do first is I'm going to show you the method that I ended up using, which was kind of a, as many things happen around here, a last minute thing, but yet it worked out perfectly for what I wanted to do with it. And it's kind of a neat alternative, but it's definitely very unconventional compared to the other ways that I'll demonstrate. Because of course we always have options for how we're going to complete our projects. So let's go ahead and jump in first. I'll show you what I did and explain why I did it. And then once we take a look at that, we'll talk about those more conventional ways to accomplish this task. Okay, so here is the back of our mirror. And as you can see, it fits right within the rabbet itself. In fact, actually, you'll notice there's a little bit of wiggle room in here. And I did that on purpose. Number one, because we want to make sure that there is room in here for wood expansion. One thing we need to think about is, depending on the width of your rails and styles, you are definitely going to have to, and also, of course, on the species that you're working with, you really need to think ahead of time about wood movement, because the last thing you want to do is have a really, really snug fit, and then, for some reason, say you have a really super humid summer and that wood really expands, whatever the reason is, you could then have the mirror be broken. And we all know what happens when you break a mirror. It's 7 years bad luck. Even if you're not superstitious, I still don't want to take a chance. But anyways, though, so we need to take that into consideration. Now, with narrower stock, it's less of a concern because you do kind of reach a point where the wood movement that is going to occur is really, really minute, but it doesn't hurt to, you know, just kind of factor that in a little bit. One question that definitely came in before we kind of get a little bit further was, did I have the mirror cut specifically for the size of the frame that I was building, or did I build the frame based on the size of the mirror that we had? And it's the second that I ended up choosing to do. My wife went out, found the mirror that she wanted, and it didn't have a frame, because sometimes you can get the mirrors with the pre-manufactured frames. And so I took the measurements, the dimensions for the mirror itself that she ended up purchasing, and I based my construction of the frame on that. So that actually worked out just a little bit easier. I mean, you could easily take a mirror, go to a glass shop, and have them custom fit it for the size you have here. One thing that some of you may have noted in the pictures is that this has some beveled edges. Working with a beveled edged mirror does kind of cause a little bit of a headache when you're trying to get it fit into the frame. But this ended up working out very nicely because I was able to kind of get it centered into position so that the bevels looked even on all sides. Now, when it came to the attachment, you'll notice there's these green little clips up here. And of course, we'll get a nice tight close up on it where we can. In the packaging for the mirror, when it ended up getting back here to the house, these clips were part of the packaging itself. They were to protect the corners, obviously, so during transportation and shipping, it wouldn't get hopefully dinged up, because the corners are definitely going to be areas where you're going to be concerned about chipping and everything. So that I ended up taking a look at these, and I thought, you know, that's a really neat idea, because one, they fit right into these corners very nicely, and it helped, to be quite honest with you, with getting this centered into position. So I ended up just taking them, and as you can see, there's this nice little, it goes all the way across here. I mean, it makes a very nice triangle. And all I did so that it wouldn't be on the front, and again, we'll get a close look at this, is I just figured out where the piece was going to be hidden behind the frame. And then I just took a nice sharp X-Acto knife, and I cut out an L so that that would not be showing on the front side. I then took what I ended up doing was over here, I took some polyurethane glue and I put those into position up there, glued them into spot, and I have those ones held there. I want these ones to stay permanent. But yet down here at the bottom, what I ended up doing is rather than applying a glue to it, I just took some screws and I screwed it into position. And a lot of that had to do with I still had a little bit more wiggle room here at either end. So it helped me to give me a really super nice snug fit. And that's all there really is to it. Now, of course, it's got a little play with it, but that's no problem because one of the alternate techniques I'm going to show you in a second will end up implementing that to get this really snug. But yet using just the shipping materials that came with it, I was able to improvise this and it worked out fine. In fact, I'll do this and you see it's not going anywhere. It's staying right in position, except for here in the middle where we're going to use one of those other techniques. Now, I do have a piece of foam down here, foam insulation, because again, there is that extra space here. And I originally was planning on maybe putting the foam all the way around, again, to add a little bit more protection and ease with any vibration. But to be quite honest with you, that's gonna take longer than it's really worth. So I just kind of have this piece in here because I did a test fit and, well, I don't feel like taking it back out, to be quite honest with you. So that's what I did with this one. Now let's take a look at what we can do with more conventional methods for getting our mirror in place. Some more conventional techniques that we could implement in getting our mirror locked into position are using things like clips. In fact, the clip I have here in my hand is just a simple window screen clip. I ended up picking this up at a local home center, and these are the type of things that you would see maybe on screen windows that kind of lock them into position. You probably even notice them on the back of, say, like more traditional picture frames. It's a really quick and easy way to kind of lock them in. In fact, I've got this little test one here, and it's really going to mess with my white balance. But as you can see, once I get it screwed into position, it's just a matter of flipping the little pieces, and you can take the mirror in and out if needed. Say, unfortunately, it does get kind of broken. Well, then you have a quick means of getting it fixed and not having to worry about it. Let me just get these back into position real quick so it doesn't slide off. There we go. So that's one way. In fact, more than likely with the mirror that I have here, rather than just having one at each corner here at the top and one at the bottom, I probably put one in the middle to help hold it in place. And in fact, like I mentioned, that's what we're gonna end up doing in the middle of this to help minimize any of that vibration. An important thing, of course, to remember is the screws that come with the kit are way too long for the material that I'm working with. So I'm gonna use an alternate screw to keep anything from happening. So the last thing I wanna do is have it poking through the front here. Now, another kind of conventional option, and maybe this one is more unconventional, but it seems conventional here in my shop, is to use something like these fender washers. Again, just pick these up at the home center. They don't have to be as big as the ones you're seeing here. They could be just a little bit smaller, but again, I took some screws, drove them in place, and it's a matter of a friction hold. Again, I probably would want to have, say, one at the top, one at the bottom, enough to really hold it in position and lock it in place. One thing I will recommend with these, using the fender washers more than, say, using these window clips, is you need to be extra cautious when you're putting these in position because you can actually crank down a little too hard and potentially break the glass. So think about that as you're putting it together. Also think about how, and we'll use the back of the mirror again over here as our example. Say we were putting them in, you gotta think about if there's any height difference from the frame or how you're gonna put it into position. So you could easily take some sort of maybe some felt or something and put it on one side of the washer that would be contacting the mirror, and that would give you a little extra pressure. It would also help to minimize the chance of you scratching it or potentially breaking it because you'd have that little cushion to ease up on the excessive pressure that you're gonna be doing because, you know, maybe you're gonna be using your drill driver or something, and you'll get a little carried away. So that's another great idea. A third kind of traditional one that was mentioned to me when asking, you know, how did I end up doing it, is taking something like some molding stock. In fact, this is just some scrap cherry that I had left over. It's very thin. As you can see, it's kind of wavy, so we might not use this one so much. But you could create a frame, a molding frame, around the back to essentially enclose the mirror. Just take some brads, put those in, something that, again, if, say, somewhere down the line you didn't like the mirror, it got scratched, something happened, you could easily undo those little brad nails, take that molding off, and replace the piece. It's kind of like, one question that came in was, well, why didn't you just simply cut a groove in the frame and then put the mirror into that? Well, my biggest concern there is, again, something happens to the mirror. If I have that groove around it and essentially enclose it, something happens, I'd have to take apart the whole entire frame, and therefore it would end up ruining the frame. Where having something like this, having one of these alternative methods to put in place, it's a matter of just removing the hardware that's keeping it in position. So definitely, if you are going to build any type of mirror or something like that, really take that into consideration. It seems really super simple to create this, you know, panel and frame type construction for the mirror, but if it's completely enclosed, well, you're kind of out of luck when it comes to having to replace it if something happens. So one more option, and you might see this quite a bit, is just simply taking some brads and shooting the brads into the actual wood itself and using those to hold the mirror in position. It works fine. It works great. It works on the same exact principles as all the other things that we've seen. So you know, easily could do that. Just again, make sure that maybe the way you shoot the brad in on the angle, then slightly bend it down so that it'll hold the frame. You don't want to have it too steep where you would end up nicking, you know, the glass itself. And then maybe even come back in with like some tape. One suggestion was, you know, could you silicone it in place? Absolutely, you could do that. But again, remember, it's just a matter of how easy do you want it to be to remove somewhere down the line, because, well, let's get serious. Stuff happens, and you're probably going to have to maybe fix it somewhere down the road. So you want to think ahead of time, what's going to be the easiest way for me to fix it so that it doesn't destroy the project that you ended up building? Or unless you really like to destroy your projects at the end of it, in which case, you know, hey, that frame and panel construction probably would work out fine. Now, another thing that we need to address that was a frequent question that came in was about the rabbets themselves. Many of you had expressed your concern about using the single blade method that we demonstrated. It's totally understandable. It's one that if you're not familiar with, I can easily see how you'd be uncomfortable with it. To be honest with you, even though I have some experience with it, there are moments where I really have to be paying just that much more attention to where I need to start and stop and how I drop it onto the blade. But at the same time, though, once you are familiar with it, you know what your safety concerns are, it's a very, very easy and quite honest with you, practical way to do it. But anyways, though, let's talk about what a couple of our other options are. Now, when it comes to doing the rabbeting, one common one that I ended up hearing was to load up a stacked dado set into the table saw and do it that way. And when you use this method, you can still use kind of that stop and start where you end up kind of dropping the material onto the blade. Now, when I say drop, I just want to emphasize it's not just simply dropping. You are doing a controlled positioning of the wood to make sure that you obviously you're gonna be able to maintain your own safety on this for concerns of kickback and such. But anyways, also dropping in the dado head cutter is one good option. A very common one that I heard quite a bit from many of you was just simply doing the rabbets with a router bit and either doing it over at the router table, which we saw us cutting some stuff over at the router table. Again, you would still have to do some sort of start and stop technique, very similar to how we saw the chamfering with it. And so we could load up a straight cutting bit and do that. Or even with the router table, we could put in a rabbeting bit and accomplish the same exact task. Or we could even do it freehand. Now, one benefit of doing it freehand is, of course, you could do the freehand before you assemble the mirror frame, or you could even do it afterwards. And to some degree, it almost makes sense to do it afterwards because you could load up a rabbeting bit and you got everything in position, and you could maybe even, once the frame is assembled, have a little bit easier time of marking out on the back side where the mirror itself is going to fit in, just in case, like myself, occasionally you kind of overcompensate a little bit with the dimensions for that fear of either one, wood movement, or two, your measuring skills are just really pretty bad. So anyways, though, if you were to do this third option where you constructed the whole mirror frame and then came in with your router to remove the material, whenever we're routing inside of a frame, it's different than when we're routing on the outside of a frame. So typically on the outside of frame, let's say that this panel here is our frame that we're going to be routing, and we want to put a decorative edge around it. This is just going to be a reminder for many of you, but just in case you're not familiar with this or you kind of slips your mind. Typically with a router, especially with one that you have a bearing on, when you're routing on the outside, you're going to move in a counterclockwise movement. This will keep the bit from pulling away from you and kind of snapping off, because the direction of the bit was actually this way. It's going to give you more control, and it's going to kind of pull itself into the wood versus shooting itself away. With the mirror frame, since we would be routing on the inside, you know, it seems like you want to go again kind of the way that you're used to, but actually when you're doing an inside frame, you want to then switch it and go clockwise around, and this is the best way to do it. Of course, you're obviously going to have to pay attention to the wood grain, because the grain direction, you could potentially have areas where there's going to be tear out. And if you've got this beautiful thing already assembled and you just have to do this last little bit, obviously any tear out is going to be not something you're going to want to deal with. But hopefully, if it did happen, it's going to be in a spot that's going to kind of be hidden away and it's manageable. But the main lesson, of course, is to remember, outside, anytime you're doing an outside edge with your router, you're going to be going around freehand, do it counterclockwise. If you're doing it inside, you always go clockwise, and you're going to get the best results. So hopefully that answers some of your questions about the alternatives of cutting the rabbets. Oh, well, actually, you know, one more, I didn't even think about this, of course, is using our rabbeting plane. But, we'll definitely come back at a later point and talk about all these really great options for cutting our rabbets. Now, one more thing that I need to address, and then we'll go ahead and wrap up today's episode, and hopefully we'll be wrapping up the construction of the mirror project. Over here at the router table, when we did our stop chamfers, one thing, again, very much like we did with the stopped rabbets, we came in, of course, and you saw how we dropped the piece down into position here. Again, many of you were really uncomfortable with that, and you kind of expressed your opinion about it, and I totally agree with you that there are definitely moments where, depending on how far from the end are, you really want to keep your hands out of the way. I mean, well, really, regardless of how far away you are from the end, you want to keep your hands out of the way. An option that we can use, and actually I'm kind of mad at myself because I had footage of this. I tried this where, rather than dropping it down into position, I ended up keeping the wood flat against the table, which would allow for a feather board here, and then fed it in this direction. Just simply slid it over, pivoted the piece so that it would then engage with the bit. And to be quite honest with you, it gave me the same exact result without having to worry about keeping it in this position and watching it fly away, because there's no way to have a feather board here to hold it. So using the pivot method, we can get a stop chamfer very nicely and get the same exact results that we had using the other method. One more thing with using our router table, what would be really nice is if I had a zero clearance fence right here. That would give me way more alignment for exactly where I want to stop and go, because as I have it right now, I actually have a gap here between the bit, and while it's still gives me exactly a reference point, there's kind of a little bit of a, if something wasn't working out right, it seems like it kind of catched the wrong way. But anyways, regardless, this pivot method is a nice alternative to the simply drop and go method. So that's going to do it for today's episode. Hopefully we answered your questions and maybe addressed some of your concerns regarding the construction of the mirror frame. And of course, if you do have more questions or concerns, don't hesitate to get a hold of us. You know how to do that. It's over at mattsbasementworkshop@gmail.com, or you can stop by the website at mattsbasementworkshop.com, where you can leave a comment in one of the show notes. And of course, we'll make sure to get an answer back to you as soon as possible if you do have a question. And who knows, maybe one of the questions you have coming in, we'll devote a whole entire show to it. I know many of you have very specific ones. But anyway, so one more thing I do want to ask before we wrap up this episode completely is, of course, if you haven't noticed by now, I really haven't made too much of a fuss about it. We have the 2012 listener survey going on, and it's a really simple survey. All we're asking for is just some basic demographic information, because as you're aware, or hopefully you're aware by now, the show is completely free, and the only way that we can keep the lights on here for some of the expenditures for hosting services, and especially for replacing any equipment, because let's get serious, cameras and computers are starting to fail as they're getting older, and we haven't really done any major upgrades around here. The only way that we can accomplish this is by advertising and having listeners like yourself make purchases through some of our affiliate links. So please forgive me if we do a little quick advertising and all that stuff. I mean, it only takes a few seconds to get through it, and it keeps the content coming to you absolutely free as it is. So click on the links that you'll find in the show notes for today. Of course, again, visit the website at mattsbasementworkshop.com. You'll find them in pretty much several of the last episodes that we have going on, and it'll only take a few minutes. And of course, I promise that none of this, there'll be no spams or anything coming to you. I keep all of your information absolutely private. And one thing I should mention is we have a contest going on for anybody who's entering the survey. If you leave your email address, which is completely optional, you have a chance to win one of our great Matt's Basement Workshop t-shirts. So it only takes a few minutes, and you really help out the show. All right, that's pretty much enough of my babbling this time. Like I said, get those questions in if you have them, and I look forward to hearing from all of you. Straight grains and sharp blades. I'll be talking to you in the next episode.